like to thank the organizers for inviting me here to this nice location at this nice conference. And then I have slightly changed the title. So originally I was going to talk about this, you know, as a side project, but now since I've seen the previous talks and I gather there is some interest here in the physics of healing the edge states of two-dimensional topological insulators, I decided to focus on this topic a bit, so I changed the title a bit, and it's now going to be a bit about parafermions, which is nothing exotic. It's doesn't have no parapsychology involved here. It's just a bit more general than Majorana fermions. So this is a project which has been done in collaboration with several people. So my PhD student Christoph Ort in Basel, Rakesh Tiwari, who's a postdoc in Basel, and then Tobias Meng, who's now in Dresden, and Chris Petter, postdoc of mine at the University of Luxembourg. So here's the outline of my talk. So first, I will tell you a bit about helical edge states of two-dimensional topological insulators. Then I will move on to investigating interface edge states or interface bound states due to the superconducting proximity effect. So basically, what I have in mind is a setup like this. So we have a two-dimensional topological insulator with an edge state, which is helical, and then we gap it out using superconductivity in these regions, and we gap it out using, as I will argue, Umklapp scattering in this middle region. And then at the interfaces, we will find then a generalization of Majorana bound states, namely these parafermion states. Moreover, I will go on to show you how these states can in principle also be realized similarly in Rushmore wires, and then I will conclude. So let's start with the helical edge states. So I will just go over this briefly because we've heard about this before. So basically a two-dimensional topological insulator has an insulating bulk, but it has metallic helical edge states, and this is shown here. So we have the bulk states, which are gapped, and then inside the gap we have these helical edge states characterized by, for instance, right movers which have spin up and left movers which have spin down. And so this is a depiction. So on the upper edge, for instance, you have right movers with spin up and left movers with spin down. On the lower edge, it's just going to be the opposite way. Now, a very important concept, which has also been mentioned various times in this conference, is for these edge states, is the concept of time-reversal symmetry. Time-reversal symmetry, as all symmetries in quantum physics, is related to an operator, which in this case is an anti-unitary operator, so theta times theta dagger is equal to minus 1. And for spin 1/2 fermions, it has the extraordinary property that this operator squares to minus 1. This fact is actually very important for the physics of helical edge states. It means that certain processes, which are usually present in all other one-dimensional systems, are prohibited in this system in the presence of time-reversal symmetry. So if I look at a Hamiltonian for this edge state, so we have, say, spin-up electrons, so this is written in second quantization now, so we have spin-up electrons with a velocity vf and spin-down electrons with a velocity minus vf, then the time-reversal operator acts as follows, so it translates a spin-up electron with momentum k to a spin-down electron with momentum minus k. But now, due to this property that it squares to minus 1, the spin-down electron with momentum k has to go to minus the spin-up electron with momentum minus k. And this minus sign is essential because, for instance, it rules out processes where one spin-up electron from the right Fermi point is scattered to a spin-down electron on the left Fermi point. So these processes in the Hamiltonian, which would be present in all other one-dimensional systems, are ruled out here. So time-reversal symmetric Hamiltonians cannot couple left movers and right movers because they are Cramer's pairs in this case. And this means that in presence of perturbations which couple these edge states remain gapless. And this is very important for transfer properties, for instance. So if you consider impurity scattering, in terms of a Hamiltonian, it corresponds to this term. So we have just some impurity potential which couples to the total density. Total density in this case meaning the sum of spin-up density and spin-down density. And if I simply express this Hamiltonian in terms of Fermilink operators using a Fourier transformation, then I find that it creates forward scattering. So it creates scattering within the right moving branches with spin-up and within the left moving branches with spin-down, but it doesn't create any back scattering. So this is a diagram, so it creates only forward scattering on a given edge. And it is well known that forward scattering doesn't change the conductance away from E squared over H. So, and again, the reason that backscattering does not emerge from this potential scattering is because, of course, this Hamiltonian is time-reversal symmetric, right? So it cannot even, in principle, produce a term which contains backscattering because this one would get a minus sign of time-reversal, so it would be time-reversal asymmetric. So the consequences of this are as has been mentioned before, that these helical edge states should have a quantized conductance of E squared over H. And if you take this argument seriously, in particular it says that this quantization should be true even in the presence of disorder and even at finer temperatures. And of course, nobody seriously believes this, but it is at least what this minimal picture predicts.
Now, with interactions.
Sorry?
With interactions.
No. So this was non-interacting system, right? But people realized very early on, even Kane and Millie realized this, that interactions can change the picture quite a bit. So interactions, they can produce inelastic backscattering. And inelastic backscattering principle is allowed even in these helical edge states. And this will then lead to a correction to the quantized conductance. But the important point to realize here is that whereas in normal 1D systems, you don't need interactions to cause backscattering in the first place, interactions, be it electron-electron interactions or electron-phonon interactions, are essential here for realizing backscattering. So this means that backscattering, whatever it is, at least it is expected to be much weaker than in normal one-dimensional metals. So we were interested in kind of gently generalizing the concept of helical systems, and then we investigated what we dubbed at this time generic helical systems. So the question was, what is the most general edge state Hamiltonian which is allowed by time reversal symmetry? So I've already presented this system, so we have right movers spin up and left movers spin down, but this is not the most general case. So this is, let's say, a conventional helical system. This is the Hamiltonian, and you see that this Hamiltonian commutes with a sigma z Pauli matrix. So this Hamiltonian, in addition to conserving time reversal symmetry, also conserves spin. And this is not the same thing. So these are really two different concepts. So this one conserves spin. Of course, it also conserves particle number. And this means it has these two symmetries, conserved particle number, conserved spin, which gives us a U1 cross U1 symmetry, reflecting in this these transformation rules. So you can multiply psi up operator and psi down operator by two independent phases, theta up and theta down. So it has a two-fold U1 symmetry, so to speak. Now, how can we generalize this Hamiltonian? So the first thing we can do, of course, is we can add the least irrelevant, or the smallest allowed, in a sense, perturbation, which is allowed by time reversal symmetry. And in this case, this would correspond to adding these terms on the off-diagonal. So I cannot add constant terms on the off-diagonal, because this would violate time reversal symmetry. But I can add terms in principle which are linear in K. And as you see, this Hamiltonian no longer commutes with sigma z. So apparently, the spin symmetry has been broken. But this is not the whole story. I mean, this is, well, if you look at the spin as a function of momentum, you find that, well, the spin quantization axis has just changed. Because the spectrum is linear and the spin orbit coupling is linear, you can just, well, pick a new spin quantization axis with respect to which you again have the same U1 cross U1 symmetry. So this means that this Hamiltonian truly doesn't break any symmetries of the problem. So it still has the U1 cross U1 symmetry. So in order to break the spin symmetry, I have to do a bit more. And actually, what I should do if I want to approach this problem properly is, since this is a 2D system, I should approach it using a two-dimensional Hamiltonian, add spin orbit coupling to this 2D Hamiltonian, and then project out the one-dimensional edge state. And this is what we did for various models. And then in general, you find something which is a bit more involved. So you still find the linear dependence on K for lowest approximation for the, for the kinetic energy. But then the spin orbit coupling, in addition to the linear terms in K, has to have cubic terms in K. And if you plot the spin quantization axis now, you see that the spin rotates as a function of momentum. And this means I cannot simply undo it by a global change of my spin quantization axis. So this model truly has only one U1 symmetry left, which corresponds to the conservation of total charge. And it's reflected, well, I can only multiply now psi up and psi down by the same common phase factor. So this is then what we call generic helical liquid. Now, what are the properties of such a helical system which has no spin symmetry? So first of all, this is the Hamiltonian. So instead of writing it in terms of spin up and spin down fermions, we now express it in terms of right movers which have plus here and left movers which have minus here and which have opposite velocity, Vf and minus Vf. But now the physical spin up and spin down fermions are related to these right movers and left movers in general by unitary transformation, which I call BK. So this BK is essentially the transformation which brings about the spin texture. And now this matrix BK can, to a certain degree, in the low energy limit, be fixed completely or almost completely by time reversal symmetry. Namely, on the one hand, BK matrix obviously it has to be unitary, and on the other hand, time reversal symmetry tells us that this BK matrix has to be a symmetric function of K, so BK is equal to B minus K. And these two properties already make it possible to express BK for small momenta in terms of a single parameter, which we call here K0. And this K0, you can kind of understand this K0 as the momentum scale over which the spin quantization axis rotates in this system. So K0 is the only thing which parameterizes the non-conservation of spin in this model. So then for momenta which are much less than K0, the BK matrix has this form, so it is 1s on the diagonal, and then minus K over K naught squared, and plus K over K naught squared on the off diagonals. So this K naught can be calculated for various models. So we did the calculation, for instance, for the BHC model in the presence of Rush-Watson orbit coupling, which governs mercury telluride, cadmium telluride quantum wells, and then also for the BHC model with structural inversion asymmetry, which is the model to use for these indium arsenide, gallium antimonide quantum wells. Question?
So this K squared is KX squared plus KY squared, right?
What?
You wrote there K over K0 squared, right?
No, this is now a 1D K, right? So this is what I get after the projection on the one-dimensional state. So this is just the linear momentum.
Okay.
Yeah. So we did this also for indium arsenide, gallium antimonide quantum wells, where we naturally have this asymmetry because of this quantum well structure. And therefore, we also naturally have this K0 without any ingredients. And also, we can realize something like this in K-Mallee Hamiltonians, which governs systems like silicene, germanine, stannine, and all graphene-like topological insulators. So basically, this term is generally present in all these Hamiltonians, and it'll give rise to this spin quantization axis rotation. So what are the experimental signatures? So we thought about quite a bit, so we published a few papers. Okay, not all by us, but also by other people. So basically, it modifies the edge conductance at finite temperatures, so we get a correction which scales as t to the fourth power at low temperature, and which is the largest correction which is allowed by time reversal symmetry for dimensional reasons. Of course, there are other mechanisms which bring about a correction of the same scale, but this is one of the possible mechanisms. Then, for instance, one can study intra-edge tunneling. If you have a narrow two-dimensional topological insulator, nano-ribbon, you can have tunneling between the upper edge modes and the lower edge modes. And in this case, this tunneling will also strongly depend on the spin texture. And then, for instance, one can, in principle, measure this using spin-resolved SDM measurements, when you just map the spin structure of the edge states. All right. But in this talk, actually, I would go a bit further and focus on interactions in these helical or generic helical systems. So the interaction Hamiltonian that I will study is just a simple density-density type interaction, which you can imagine as being brought about by weakly screened Coulomb interactions in these helical edge states. So it's just a term which couples density and density at different positions. So, but now density, again, is spin up plus spin down density. And again, this has now to be brought to the basis of my right movers and left movers. And in this basis transformation, I encounter again this matrix BK. So translating the density operator like this, and then inserting the spin operators as a function of right movers and left movers, I get various terms of the interaction Hamiltonian. So on the one hand, the simplest term I get is a pure density-density interaction, now in terms of right movers and left movers. So basically right mover density plus left mover density total squared. But in addition to this, I get other terms. So for instance, one term I get is single particle backscattering. So this is illustrated by this Feynman diagram. So I have to say, two right movers coming in, and then one of the right movers, well, remains a right mover, and the other right mover is backscattered into a left mover. And the vertex factor here scales with the difference in these momenta squared. So this is one term I get, and the other term I get is two particle backscattering, which is also often called Umklapp scattering. This looks like this, so we have two right movers coming in and two left movers going out, and each of these vertices carries a difference in momentum squared factor. And now, of course, since we have this Umklapp scattering, the question is, can it open a gap in the system?
Oh, sorry, because you include this K into lambdas, right? So lambda are K-dependent.
Say again?
So you said that the vertex is proportional to the difference of momenta squared.
Yep.
This is included in the lambda 1 or lambda 2, no?
Right, yeah, yeah, okay.
So this lambda is proportional to the momentum factor.
Exactly. So this is a very schematic way of writing it, right? So you can either say that this prefactor contains the momentum difference, or that this operator contains additional derivatives in real space, right?
Yeah.
Right. Other question? Yeah.
How do you consider the momentum?
Good question. I come to that. So the question is, can this term open a gap? And well, the general answer is no. So because this term, well, it wants to scatter two right movers into two left movers, and in general, it can either conserve momentum or energy. So for instance, this one conserves energy, but it doesn't conserve momentum. But this process is possible if I place my chemical potential at the Dirac point. So in that case, I can scatter two right movers, so the red things here, into two left movers, the blue particles, and this process now can conserve energy, both energy and momentum. And so, and then it is known that once such a term becomes relevant, normally it's going to open up a gap in the spectrum. So this is our expectation here. So the question is, can this Umklapp scattering term open a gap in the spectrum of the helical edge state, despite the fact that I still have time reversal symmetry? Okay, to understand this, we did a renormalization group analysis using Bosonization. So basically we use the Bosonization identity for the right movers and left movers. So we express the fermionic operators as exponential or bosonic operators, which are canonical and conjugate. And the RG proceeds by, you know, studying the system as a function of this cutoff, this short distance cutoff A, which we vary in the RG flow. And if we do this, so first Bosonize the Hamiltonian, then do this RG transformation, we find the following. So the Bosonized Hamiltonian contains, well, kinetic plus density-density interaction term, which gives us Luttinger Hamiltonian, which is characterized by now a renormalized Fermi velocity and this Luttinger parameter K, which is between 0 and 1 for repulsively interacting fermions. And now the single particle backscattering gives rise to this term H1, and it contains this, well, rather complicated expressions in terms of bosonic operators, and it has this dependence on the cutoff scale, so A to the power K plus 1. And then if I take the Umklapp scattering I gave you on the previous slide, then I get this Hamiltonian, it contains cosine 4 phi, and it comes with the prefactor A to the power of 4k. Okay, now I should point out that this Hamiltonian, well, is now in the bosonic basis, so we have to make sure, or I mean, just for interest, we also would like to understand what time reversal symmetry means in the bosonic basis. And it turns out you can define it like this. So you can define time reversal symmetry, so basically the way to analyze this is, well, you have to make sure that if you use this bosonization identity, then time reversal symmetry gives you the same which you would expect it to give for fermions. And using this, one can come up with these rules. Basically, the field phi under time reversal goes to phi plus pi over 2, whereas the field theta under time reversal changes sign, goes to minus theta, and also plus pi over 2. So these are the transformation rules for the bosonic basis. Okay, and now, well, if we look at the scaling dimension of these operators, then to our dismay, we find out that they are both RG irrelevant. So this means that this Umklapp scattering can never open a gap. So, but it turns out that in the field theory language, this term H1 is what would be called a term which is dangerously irrelevant. So this means it is a term which is formally irrelevant, but whose RG flow can generate a term in the Hamiltonian, a new term, which is then RG relevant. And this is what I'm going to show. So we take again the Hamiltonian for single particle backscattering. And now we, well, do our perturbative RG calculation to second order in this term. To second order, we get this diagram. So we get two single particle backscattering processes. So here, one right mover is backscattered into one left mover. This one remains a right mover. And then in the second step, this right mover is also backscattered into this left mover. So we have two right movers in the initial state, two left movers in the final state, so we have something like Umklapp scattering, but now this is a higher order process. And it, yep?
So you do it in fermions, right? So this actually looks like...
No, we do it in bosonic language. I mean, I just draw through this diagram to make it more understandable, but the RG is done in bosonic language. So, and then it turns out that this intermediate state cancels part of the momentum dependence which we have in these vertices, and then it turns out that this actually, the RG flow of this operator gives us a relevant term. So this one gives us an Umklapp term again, it contains the same cosine 4 phi, but now it has a cutoff dependence which is different. So now it contains A to 4k minus 2.
Sorry.
Yep.
Isn't that the same local operator that you wrote down? I mean, irrespective of the prefactor.
Yeah, it is the same local operator, but it is a different prefactor.
But then it must have the same scaling
dimension. No, we can talk about this later. But for the scaling dimension, I mean, you always have to find the dimensionless coupling constant. And then it matters a lot what this prefactor is constructed from. So I think maybe the easiest way is to understand it from the fermion calculation. So, so in terms of fermions, where is my envelope scattering? Right. This process has a certain momentum dependence. And now if you generate this process by a second order term, this one, it may, so this intermediate state here, this intermediate state momentum dependence may cancel some of the momentum dependence in the original scattering term. And this, so basically we get a factor k squared here and a factor k squared here. But this intermediate state, so the energy denominator in the intermediate state cancels some of this momentum dependence. Which is why this term actually brings us something which, from the Bose-Ness point of view, is identical to the one we had previously, but which has a different cutoff dependence.
So yeah? From that k1 minus k2 squared, so this momentum dependence is the vertices. So it makes the forward scattering suppress somehow, right? And that is that important?
Say again?
So so you change this, you generate some other terms by having this different dependence on k1 minus k2, right? So you get this, is it something which is a new element here? So it's not a constant, right? So your momentum dependence is important here, right?
The momentum dependence is very important, exactly. So, so basically, maybe I should say it like this. So, you know, the common point of view in, let's say, field theoretical treatments is that we write down every operator which is allowed by symmetry, right? And then it is clear that this cosine Hamiltonian in principle is allowed because it satisfies time inverse symmetry. What we wanted to do is we would like to find a microscopic Hamiltonian in terms of fermions which produces a relevant cosine term. And it turns out that in fermions, well, the simple Umlauf scattering which I generate, which I have on the previous slide, is not enough. It gives a term which has this form, but it has a cutoff dependence which is such that this Hamiltonian turns out remains irrelevant. And then this second order term, so the second order scattering term, has in a sense a lower momentum dependence and therefore gets a term which under RG becomes relevant.
But, I mean, it can only happen if this thing is a non-local object. I mean, if I think of it as, in some sense, what you're doing is, you would say, conformal perturbation theory, right? So you have a slew of operators, mm-hmm. and by general principles, I should be able to get the scaling dimension of each one of those operators by just, you know, putting it into a correlator. So, I mean, if it's not a non-local object, I don't understand how this is different from the uncaught guy you had in the previous slide. I mean, I know you're saying that some of the prefacts are different, but...
Yeah. This is the important thing. But you would agree from the fermionic language it's quite clear, right?
Well, I'm not sure, because for the one particle on-clop, or sorry, the two particle on-clop, the thing you had on the previous slide, if I write that in terms of right-left movers, it's like r dagger squared l squared, which really means like r dagger ddx r dagger l l ddx l plus termination constant.
No,
right?
So it's not actually, no. This is the point, it's not that. So if I bosonize, or if I write term, I mean this term, this Umlauf term, it has k to the power 4, right? So it contains four derivatives. And this is two more than is required. I mean, you said r dagger dxr, l dxl. So this one contains four derivatives, which means it still gives a cosine term when you bosonize it, but with a prefactor, which is now irrelevant. And this is the point. So basically, going to second order kills us two of these derivatives, which then gives the term you mentioned, r dagger dxr, l dxl.
Yep. So I compare the new term with H2, right? And A is not dimensionless.
Exactly, yes.
Right? So it must be, in order for the terms to have the same dimensions, the same units, right?
Right, yeah.
I need to
sure.
divide it by some other length scale.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm. So what is the length scale?
So basically this term what enters here is, well, you can see this diagram basically. So the prefactor for the single particle backscattering enters twice here. So in a sense, it's proportional to lambda 1 squared, and then I think divided by 1 VF. So, but yeah, I mean, of course, I mean, this A has a dimension, that's true, yes.
Okay.
Thomas, just maybe to connect to Matt's question, if you refermionize your iterator, right, so you would get a similar structure with less derivatives. So is this the same?
If I refermionize this one, I get what you mentioned.
Yeah. Okay.
If I refermionize the one before,
so you still need a Lutner parameter that's less than one.
For this one?
Yeah.
Oh, less than one half even.
Right.
To make it relative.
Okay.
Yeah, sure. Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So these are the RG equations. So basically, the point is here that the RG equation for this factor, for this prefactor, contains this k minus one half, which makes it relevant for k less than one half. But it contains this second order term in lambda one, which means that even if G umlaut is initially zero, which it is if we start from our Fermionic Hamiltonian, then it'll be generated in the RG flux, in the RG flux of this lambda one. All right, so this umlaut scattering we find relevant for k less one half. It then opens a gap in the agitated spectrum. So again, what is the point of this exercise? I mean, the existence of this term based on symmetry arguments has been known since the paper by Ken and Millie. So our aim was to basically, well, look at the microscopic prefactor of this term if I come from fermions plus Rochefort small orbit coupling. And so the essential ingredients that we need to get this term is we need to have density-density interaction, and then also, of course, we need to have a mechanism which breaks the spin symmetry, right? It cannot exist in a spin-conserving system. And this mechanism we propose is this nonlinear Rochefort small orbit coupling. As I said before, even linear Rochefort small orbit coupling is not going to help because you need something which truly breaks one-U-one symmetry. All right, so let's move on to the interface edge states. So, well, we have also seen this before at this conference. So basically, if I want to have exciting interface state physics in these systems, then I need to gap them out somehow. And what are the ways to gap out these edge states? So on the one hand, I can use superconductivity, which corresponds to this pairing term. It preserves time reversal symmetry. It also conserves spin because it generates spin up and spin down. And the gap, if I want to use a topological classification of the gap turns out to be topologically non-trivial. Well, the other way to gap it out is by using a magnetic field. So it corresponds to this Zeeman-like term, so Zeeman field in x direction. It breaks time reversal symmetry. It also breaks spin symmetry. And by the same topological classification, this term is topologically trivial. So what now we have a third, oh, sorry. I should mention that this was proposed in this seminal paper by Fu and Kane. So basically, we have a 2D topological insulator, which we wrap into a ring here, and then we bring a superconductor on top of some section of it, and then we have this section here gapped out by magnetic field, this one, the rest gapped out by superconductivity. And then we have these Majorana fermions, which are sitting here at the edges, and these are described by operators, so fermionic operators essentially, which are self-adjoint, so gamma is equal to gamma dagger. And they are at zero energy, so they are the only gap modes in this system. They are the only modes in the gap in this system. So now we would like to understand what are the bound states if we replace the magnetic field by umlaut scattering. So we replace this operator, which is not time reversal symmetric, by this operator, this umlaut operator, which now preserves time reversal symmetry. So it preserves time reversal symmetry, it also breaks spin symmetry, and the gap is, in a sense, topologically trivial in the sense that this gap is adiabatically connected to this gap. I'm not sure if, I mean, the topological classification for interacting system is much more complicated than for a non-interacting system, but if you want to assign a topological quality to this term, then I would consider it topologically trivial. So the question is, then we have bound states here and here at the interfaces between superconducting regions and, let's say, regions gapped out by umlaut scattering, which I will call mod insulating regions. And the question is, what is the nature of these bound states there? So to investigate this, we first look at a single junction. So we have a superconducting region here and the mod insulating region here. So there's a slight caveat because actually I told you that to have superconductivity, to have umlaut scattering relevant, we must have k less than one half. Whereas superconductivity for this operator to be relevant, we actually need k greater than one half. So this is a bit of a disagreement here. But it's not so bad, because actually one can show rather easily that superconductors also screen interactions. So if we place a superconductor here, then it's very possible that if the bare Luttinger parameter is close to one half, that this superconductivity can bring it slightly above one half, where superconductivity becomes relevant. All right, so then we have this superconducting Hamiltonian here, which corresponds to a sine 2 theta term. We have umlaut scattering here, which corresponds to this cosine 4 phi term. we need to take care that the chemical potential is at the Dirac point, because otherwise envelope scattering is not allowed. All right, so now we would like to investigate the system, and this is not so easy. What one can do is a kind of mean field approximation, if this is the right word. So basically, we assume that since both of these terms are relevant in their respective regions, that the superconductor essentially pins the field theta to a minimum of the sine function. So for instance, to a theta equals approximately minus pi over 4 in the superconducting regions, whereas the molten insulator similarly pins the phi field to a minimum of the cosine. So this is pinned to then approximately pi over 4. But of course, one has to take into account that these two fields do not commute, right? So we cannot pin them both in a sense. So then in this mean field approximation, I can expand about these minima, and then I find that basically in the superconducting region, I get a term theta squared, and in the modern insulating region, I get a term phi squared. And then what I can do, for instance, is I can just use this kind of mean field-like Hamiltonian to calculate this Fermi-Green's function, this psi-psi correlation, psi-psi-Degas correlation function, using the Bose-Nerth language. And then I find that at the position x equal to 0, so at the interface, as a function of imaginary frequency, this retarded Green's function has a singularity or has a pole at energy 0, right? And this is already a first indicator which tells me that, okay, there can be zero energy bound states in this case. Well, we would like to understand a bit better what is the nature of these bound states. So for instance, or as one example, we would like to understand the ground state degeneracy. So for this, we follow basically the procedure which has been brought forward in this paper by Lindner and Adi Stern and collaborators. And here the idea is, well, basically we construct operators which bring us from one ground state to the other ground state. And by looking at the number of these operators, we find the ground state degeneracy. So it's important to note that in the Mott insulating regions, we conserve spin modulo 4. So basically, I have psi up, Degas, psi up, Degas, psi down, psi down. So these interaction processes change spin by 4 units. Whereas in the superconducting regions, I conserve spin completely, but I conserve charge only modulo 2. Right. So and these modulo 4 and modulo 2 conservations of spin and charge, respectively, are important for addressing the ground state degeneracy. So what we can define at the mean field level are charge and spin operators. Basically, the charge operators, Qj, is the difference in charge by between neighboring Mott insulating regions. So in each Mott insulating region, charge is conserved. So I can define the difference in charges between two Mott insulating regions. And then I find that these charges, well, this operator can take on 4 different values and is half quantized. Similarly, I can define spin operators, Sj, by differences in these theta fields. So spin in the Mott insulating region is not well defined, but in the superconducting region, spin is conserved, so it is well defined. So I can take the differences of two superconducting regions and define the spin between two superconducting regions. And this spin is then quantized because of this fourfold, or because of this conservation of parity modulo 4, has 4 possible values. But again, these operators do not commute because they involve these phi and theta fields. And then at the mean field level, one finds that these exponentials of these operators, e to I pi s over 2 and e to I pi q, they commute with the Hamiltonian at the mean field level. So these are candidates for conserved quantities. And of course, I have to take care that these do not commute. So I cannot use all of these operators, but I can construct a maximum set of these operators which commute with the Hamiltonian at mean field level. And then I find I can parameterize the ground state like this. So I can specify, for instance, s minus 1 of these spin quantum numbers, which gives me a ground state of 4 to the power n minus 1. And in addition, I can specify the total spin and the total charge. And each of these give me an additional degeneracy of 2. And so the total degeneracy, if I have n of these junctions, would be 4 to the power n. So this means if I have a single junction, so this means, let's say, superconductor, modern state, superconductor, then I have a 4-fold ground state degeneracy, which is double the degeneracy I would expect from my Urana fermions. And this is easy to understand. So in a sense, that twice the double degeneracy comes about because in addition to the parity symmetry, we now have also time reversal symmetry. So let me talk a bit more about these interface polar particles. So I already said that they have quantized charges, quantized charge in units of E over 2. So This Q operator basically just has eigenvalues which are half quantized, and this is very similar in theory to what we've also seen before here, namely the Schrieffer-Hager model or the Jacques-Rebbe model, which predicts similar half quantized bound states. So now we construct operators which allow us to go from one of these ground states to the other one. So these operators can be, well, first we define operators which increase charge and spin in a respective region, so they can be defined as products of these exponentials. And then from these operators, which are still somewhat non-local operators, in a sense they are related to string operators, we can construct local operators by taking products like this. And then these operators, chi, they act locally within the ground state subspace. And it turns out that these chi operators then satisfy something which is called a Z4 paraformulating algebra. So basically, chi j, chi k is e to minus I pi over 2 times chi k, chi j. So for my Rolle fermions, this factor would just be minus 1. But here in this case, for these Z4 paraformulants, it's minus I. And also, in contrast to my Rolle fermions, I have to raise these operators to the power 4 to give 1 and not to the power 2, as with my Rolle fermions. So what are the experimental signatures? Basically, there's one signature which is very important, namely an 8 pi Peredic-Johnson effect. This basically follows from the fact that they have E over 2 charges. And another effect, which I will talk about briefly now, is they also fulfill non-abelian braiding statistics. Okay, so let me talk about this a bit. So what is braiding? So basically, I think the easiest way to imagine is if you start from a 2D system. So let's say we have a P plus IP, P wave superconductor. Then we may have vortices in this system. And you know, as illustrated here, we can kind of bring these vortices around each other. And I mean, this was also nicely mentioned in Anton's talk. And then by bringing these vortices around each other, we can go from one ground state to the other one. And this is the essential, this is the essence of braiding. So for instance, in this P-wave superconductor, around each of these vortices, the phase of the superconducting order parameter changes by 2 pi because it's a P-wave state. And so this means that along or across these lines, these branch cuts, which I can put there arbitrarily, but I have to put them somewhere. And if I go across these branch cuts, my phase changes by 2 pi. Now I want to exchange two vortices adiabatically. And so basically I bring this gamma 2 bound state around this gamma 1 bound state, and I bring this gamma 1 here upstairs. And then I have to drag along this branch cut, but ultimately to get again back to something which looks like the initial state, one of these branch, so this branch cut has to cross the other branch cut. And basically one can argue that, well, during this crossing, one of these states has to pick up a phase pi, so then one of them goes to minus itself. And this is the operator which corresponds to this braiding statistic. So gamma 1 on the braiding goes to gamma 2, but gamma 2 goes to minus gamma 1. And one can show that this can be really used to implement certain transformations if I view multiple Majorana states as a qubit. So this is called non-abelian exchange statistics. So the question is, can we do something similar in our system with our parafermionic states? And of course, I mean, the obvious problem is that, well, it's a 1D system, right? So we cannot really move them around in a two-dimensional plane, so we have to be a bit more creative. And there, something is possible which is very closely related to what Anton told us yesterday about, basically, we kind of realize a braiding by tuning the parameters of the Hamiltonian adiabatically. And this can be done here, so we move the states in a sense by repeatedly creating new pairs and fusing pairs of these states. So let's say we start from this system where we have, I think, superconductor here in these blue regions and mod insulating in the red region. We have two bound states. Then we nucleate a new pair of bound states by, well, making a short section here superconducting, so this brings a new pair here. Then we move one of these pairs, well, out here, further out here. And then ultimately we merge these two parafermions here. And then one can show quite generally that then, in a sense, the quantum state of this yellow bound state will be transferred to this, let's say, sister of this state which I nucleated. Right? So basically, I nucleate new states, I merge one of them with the existing state, and then the state of the previous state goes to the other of these ancilla states.
Sorry, but like this, you're not guaranteed that the ones that you fuse will be in the ground state.
Well, you have to do it adiabatically, right?
No, but even then, so the state of the two ones that you created is arbitrary. So there's no definite fusion outcome of the two states that you fuse first.
I mean, you just have to, I must admit, I don't know a good physical argument for this. I mean, you just have to do the calculation here. You nucleate a new pair, and then you just bring it out, and then you find that it's in the same state. I mean, for Majorana fermions, apparently this has been known for a long time, but for these parafermions, one can also show just using the calculation.
No, but so is the new pair coupled when you are performing a fusion, or is the coupling already zero?
Yeah, the coupling is zero, right? I mean, here.
Then there is no way that so then there is no constraint on the fusion outcome of the initial parafermion with the final one. So,
well,
first of all, several fusion outcomes are physically possible.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And second, you're not creating. So these are you're taking two parafermions which have no reason to be in a definitive state. So
well, you know, each ground state is characterized by a given parity in the spin sector and by a given parity in the charge sector. And because I cannot just create charge by doing this, and I cannot create spin, they have to have been in a certain state, right? So charge and spin are conserved in my overall system. I mean, we can talk about this later. I think it's something which comes up from the calculations. All right. So basically, this is the idea. So keep this picture in mind. So I create a pair of new states, and then I bring the state to the other pair of the newly created state. So this I can used to realize this Brayton diffusion. So let's assume I start with my particles on a circle, so and I want to exchange the position of this red one and this blue one. Then, for instance, I can bring the red one and this yellow one together. So as a consequence, they will turn yellow, and then the state of this red one will be transferred to the other yellow one, to this one, so this one becomes red. Next, I bring them out again, so I have now yellow, red, yellow, blue. And then I bring these two close together, so the yellow one and the blue one, and then they too become yellow, and then the state of the blue one is transferred onto the other yellow one, which means here. Right? So in the end, I have a state which looks like this, and then only I have to turn this circle by 180 degrees, and then you see that actually the red one and the blue one have been interchanged. So this is how it's possible to implement this kind of braiding, even if you cannot move around these particles in real space. So basically, the only thing we need to do is we need to be able to move the edge states, and we need to be able to bring these particles close together. And admittedly, doing this in a topological insulator is going to be tricky, but in principle, one could do it by, starting with a topological insulator where we can actually tune the position of the edge states using gate voltages. So indium arsenide, gallium antimonide would be a candidate. I think mercury telluride is going to be harder. And then also by playing with a superconducting proximity effect. So a superconducting proximity effect can also be screened to some degree. There have been experiments showing that. Then if we imagine that we can turn on and off superconductivity in certain regions, we can really bring these states pairwise together. So for example, this one couples this state, and then here we couple these states. And then a principle, well, if you use some imaginations, this may be usable for braiding. But then, yeah, we still have to show that it is really braiding, so we have to construct explicitly the braiding operator, and we did this, and we really found that this satisfies these Young-Baxter equations, which is shown here. So basically, for this to be a representation of the braid group, it should be irrelevant if you first exchange 1 and 2, then 2, 3, then 1, 2, or do it the other way around, first exchange 2, 3, then 1, 2, then 2, 3. So these two braids should be equivalent, and this can be easily checked using these operators. All right, so in the last 2 minutes or so, let me talk briefly about how this generalizes to Rushmore wires. So in a Rushmore wire, we already talked about this. So we start from a system which has quadratic spectrum, then we add Rushmore spin orbit coupling, which lifts the degeneracy of spin up and spin down, so it shifts these parabolas with respect to one another. And then we open a gap, usually, if you want to see Majorana fermions, by a magnetic field perpendicular to the Rushmore axis, and this opens a gap of which with 2BZ. And this system, if you then look at the spin texture, it has an interesting spin texture, so it has almost spin down here, it has almost spin up here, so at low energies you can regard this as a helical electron system, and this is the reason why basically most of the physics from topological insulator edge states, as far as my runner fermions are concerned, also applies to these Rushmore systems, and this is why we can find Majorana frameworks in these systems. So then, by analogy to what I just said, the question that we had is, can we replace also in these systems the magnetic field, which we usually use to get Majorana fermions, by Umlauf scattering, by time reversal invariant Umlauf scattering? Well, and the answer is yes, but still is yes, but still we have to go a bit more in detail. So we have to kind of generalize this Umlauf scattering, and this Umlauf scattering has to violate spin conservation. But it is actually quite easy to see how it's possible. I mean, this 1D Hamiltonian still conserves spin, right? So this one still conserves with sigma z. So we have to find a way to break the sigma z conservation, but actually it's quite easy if you go to higher subbands. So if you start from a two-dimensional Rochefort Hamiltonian, then actually, well, let's assume it's free in one direction, x direction, and it's confined in the y direction. But then in the y direction, the Rochefort Hamiltonian actually contains a sigma y Pauli matrix. So, and this sigma y times py term actually breaks this sigma z symmetry. And this means that inter-subband transitions always come with a spin flip. And then if you have transitions, transitions involving virtual excursions to higher subbands, then you can realize also something like Umlauf scattering. So this is shown here. Let's assume we start with two spin up electrons in the lowest subband, and then each of them make a virtual transition to the first excited subband undergoing a spin flip, so they go to one down and one down here. Then they interact via a normal density type Coulomb interaction. And of course, the Coulomb interaction as such couples states in different subbands, right? So they can change subbands under interaction, but they cannot change spin because Coulomb interaction conserves spin. So then this one down goes to zero down, and this one down also goes to zero down. So ultimately what I've achieved is I have taken two spin up states in the lowest subbands and created two spin down states in the lowest subband. So within the lowest subband, this just gives Umlauf scattering. And again, the Umlauf scattering is going to be relevant if I place my chemical potential in such a way that it is allowed, that the process is allowed by spin, by energy momentum conservation. Well, and then we did an RG analysis, and again, it is more complicated than for the helical states because you always have this kind of charge and spin degrees of freedom floating around, but one still finds that because of spin orbit coupling, Umlauf scattering can become relevant for strong interactions. And then we don't want to go so far as to say that we can braid in this system because the RG calculation reveals that we always need to have a wire which has a finite length, right? So, and in a finite length system, actually braiding is, it's not topologically protected in a sense because you always have corrections which are exponentially suppressed in the length, but they are finite in a finite length system. But still, what one can see here, in principle, is an 8-pi periodic Josephson effect, because this is just related to the quantized charge of E over 2 carried by these bound states. So this means that if we place a Rochefort wire on superconductors with a phase difference, then due to the appearance of these bound states, one should also in these systems observe an 8-pi periodic Josephson effect. All right, so this is all I wanted to tell you. So strong interactions can open a gap in time reversal invariant, 2D topological insulators, and Rochefort wires. But we need some mechanism to break spin symmetry, right? So we need some spin orbit coupling or things like this. And then the interfaces between these mod insulating regions and superconducting regions generally pin these zero energy bound states, which are fourfold degenerate. And this degeneracy in connection with the E over 2 charge carried by these bound states leads to an 8-pi periodic Josephson effect. All right, thank you very much.
A question.
Yeah.
So you have four